80% of success is showing up. Filmmaker Woody Allen is credited for that famous quote. So one can imagine from that statement alone what it means when we hear about 10,000 kids in the Rochester City School District are identified as chronically absent. That means they don't show up for 10% or more of school over the course of the school year. I've heard teachers and education leaders say this can be fixed. Joining me to discuss how the city school district intends to do just that, I'm joined by Jerome Underwood, Senior Director of Youth Development and Family Services with the district, along with Nancy Forge, Deputy Commissioner of the Department of Human Services from Monroe County. And welcome to you both.
Thank you.
So in preparing for this conversation and in my reading and looking at the reasons why kids don't show up to school, why they're labeled chronically absent or truant, the reasons are, in a word, complex. And Jerome, I've heard you knock on doors to find kids. You go to barbershops, you show up in churches. And I want to get a sense of when you meet with families, when you track them down, track down kids, what are the reasons? What are the reasons that they're telling you it's are preventing their kids from getting to school?
Well, complex is a really, really good way to describe it. There are no one, two, or three reasons. Unfortunately, we happen to live in the fifth poorest city in the country. And a lot of the reasons that families are telling us that become barriers to children attending school at a rate of 95% or more are couched in poverty. As an example, housing. Well, Mr. Underwood, we're getting evicted next week, and that's my focus. Mental, physical, substance abuse, unemployment, depression. You know, and you know, of course, there's issues around transportation. Yes, but we find that the adult reasons really trump the kid reasons for children attending school, particularly at the earlier grades, where you know we don't introduce the word truancy until we're in high school, middle and high school. You know, our focus is on
K-3. The decision on that is because
exactly.
It's a choice. You feel like more so.
Absolutely.
Okay. I want to throw out a number just so our viewers know this. According to your latest data that you share with me, district-wide K through third grade chronic absences have declined from nearly 37% in the 2013-14 school year to 30% in the 2014-15 school year. Aside from the attendance blitzes, if people aren't familiar, this is when community members and folks with the district go out and knock on doors for kids who are chronically absent. What are you doing that's different?
The lady sitting next to me is a great example of that. The county has really embraced the partnership of addressing this. This is not a school district issue. This is a community issue. And the county has partnered with us in a big way because we have the same customer. And what they're doing collectively with us and even by themselves in terms of reaching out to families to find out what are the reasons. We're resource rich in this town, but utilization poor. So when we find out what the reasons are, we're trying to close those gaps. In other words, I mentioned housing, referring people to the housing authority, mental health, there's the Mental Health Association, jobs, all those things. The transportation, it's internal. However, with our transportation policy, we're looking to community partners such as churches who have vans parked. Can you pick up those children, particularly in the winter months, inside our mile and a half, which our district policy is, to help out? So there are a variety of things we're doing in addition to the attendance blitzes.
Mm-hmm. You pointed to Nancy, so I want to make sure to tie you into this. Talk to me about this, because I know that you are collaborating with the district at School 22, and this
Correct.
Is a pilot attendance initiative program, we can say.
Right.
And I want to know a little bit about it. What's happening? What services are being offered to families at this school?
So as a pilot, it's a kind of a work in progress, but through the county's work with the attendance blitzes in Jerome and the district staff, we identified that in some cases it's not enough just to knock on the door and remind parents to get their kids to school. As Jerome talked about, people lead complex lives and they don't always know where the next step to go is, or the kids are the last, school attendance ends up being the last priority when you're homeless or you don't have food. So this project, RED, Rapid Engagement Development, is modeled after a very successful project that the county has had with the chronically homeless and substance abusers. And we tried to use the same model. Go in with a team, develop a little trust with the family, find out what their major barriers are, and link them to an established community service so that they can begin on the path towards, you know, just corrective action and improving their family dynamics.
So about how many families are you working with approximately within school 22?
50.
About 50 families.
Yes.
All right. Well, we're going to meet one of those families right now. It's a parent I spoke with, Andrew Nelson, and he has a second grader and a preschooler, pre-K student attending school 22. And his oldest daughter, he explained the difficulties in getting Chrissy to school. And I think it's important for people to hear this story and to hear his reason behind it. So we'll take a look at this video.
My daughter and I are asthmatic, so once the weather gets below 20 degrees, actually, like say 21 below or lower than 21 degrees, the cold air chokes us, you know? So she couldn't stand outside. We talked about trying to get her on a school bus. He gave me a paper to take to the school, to her doctor. And the doctor on the paper put mild, all right? And he put her case was mild, you know? And, you know, the transportation department wanted the doctor to say she was severe. And the doctor said that she couldn't say that she was severe because it was being controlled. You know, her medication was controlling it indoors. It didn't cover her outdoors. So we sent the letter off to the transportation department. They came back and they said, well, because of where she stayed. If she stayed in this house here, she would have been able to get a school bus. But because she stayed at this house at the time, she fell one house short of being able
to walk.
So she had to walk. And 22 school was like, way down there. That was too far for her to walk with her asthma. So it was a thing to where me as a parent had to make that judgment. I mean, okay, listen, if she's missing a lot of days, she's gonna have to miss a lot of days. If you can't help me to get her to school, knowing I want her to go to school and she wants to be in school, then my hands are tied. I'm not gonna jeopardize my daughter's health just for her to be a statistic on a board.
And an important perspective to hear. Richard Rothstein of the Economic Policy Institute says asthma has become the biggest cause of chronic school absence. Mm-hmm. And one thing that we didn't hear in this clip, Andrew described to me how supportive School 22 has been in finding ways to work around the transportation issue to make sure that his daughter is able to get to school. Right. I want to know how much of the responsibility falls to the school? Because this can't be just on the district or on community agencies. What's the school's responsibility?
We share the responsibility. Our colleagues at the school, they're closest to the families. They have the best intelligence. The family in the piece and the families we're working with the county, their children were severely chronically absent, meaning that they missed more than 20% of school, and those are these 50 families. So the school has done all that it can do. So they refer, you know, to us at central office, and we, you know, get with our community partners, because when we think of this young lady and think of what, you know, Mr. Nelson said, you know, the health of his daughter is his primary concern, which we share that. So when we look at the resources that the community has, you know, what's his web of support? Whether it's a church or community agency who is not only in tune to what his needs are, but responsive to them. You know, Dr. Vargas always said that we can't do it alone.
Right.
So
we're
trying to elicit, first of all, the awareness of the entire community that this is a huge issue. No family, every family is unique almost, but there's some common things. So we're trying to create the awareness. And secondly, hopefully that awareness results in behavior change. Maybe whatever organization he belongs to, or if he's not part of an organization, to belong to one whereby there's like, you know what? They live inside of that mile and a half transportation zone. Can we drive around and pick up those kids, particularly in the winter months where we know the weather can be quite severe?
And then in terms of where the Department of Human Services comes in is making sure that those connections are made, which is critical because oftentimes it's not being aware of what is available and how to access some of those resources. And Jerome, you mentioned this to me, and I want to make sure we get this in before we close. You are trying to expand this into even the business community and making sure the business community is aware of this. You told me a story, and I wonder if you can just summarize briefly. It really hit home with me of a young man who is the sole provider of his family and couldn't go to school because he was working.
Yeah, I met a young man last year knocking on doors, and he was 16 years old. And his mother had an illness that prevented her from working. He was the worker. His job only allowed him to work between 10 in the morning and 4 in the afternoon, and they would not adjust his time. So we want our employers to be aware that a 16-year-old should be in school and try to have some flexibility.
Nancy Forge and Jerome Underwood, thank you both for your time. I appreciate it. This is just the beginning of our examination of the ripple effect of chronic absenteeism and truancy. We will continue to look at what's being done and what can be done within the district and the community to address student absence. September is Attendance Awareness Month. To learn more about what you can do to help, go to awareness.attendanceworks.org.